Hey everyone, welcome back to Linux Weekly, daily Wednesdays where we sit back, relax, take that midweek break, talk about some of the fun things going on in the world of Linux and open source. I'm Vin Stone, that's Joe Bryan, everybody
hello, watching us
live on Twitch. Twitch bridge is down, so if you type in anything and it doesn't show up on Twitch from Discord, I'm like, oops, but don't worry, you can always pop over to Twitch and we'll have it fixed next time we reset the bot. So, no worries there. Playing around with a bunch of stuff. I think our big news, we're both going to talk about, Jill, Twitter got a new name, didn't it?
X.
And people care for some reason.
Yeah. I don't really care too much, although I like that. I like tweeting and birds. So, but Elon Musk had renamed the company to X Corp not that long ago. So I knew it was going to change.
X Corp is going to be like the holding
The
organization. That dude has had the X domain name since the 90s, which was kind of interesting to keep track of that. However, that looks a lot like the X logo, doesn't it?
Yeah.
This is my only comment on it because I don't have any attachments, as I've stated, to social media networks. I'm like, whatever, do whatever you want with it. It looks like X11, XOR.
That was the first thing
I thought when I saw it. I'm like, that looks
old school.
Yeah, and I'm like, couldn't we pick something a little more original than that? However, that has spurred me to start a campaign. Let's rename, see if we can get Mastodon renamed to Wayland. So we can have like X versus Wayland social media edition.
Yeah, there we go. Good one, Vin.
Come on. Let's just do it. Do it for a little bit.
Oh boy. I think Xorg is a better name for a social media platform than Wayland. I'm kidding.
So you got a meetup coming up?
Yeah. So actually, we had a meetup on Sunday where we started talking about doing preparations for the Southern California Linux Expo next year, Scale 21X. And Happy Cube in chat was there. He joined us. That's my friend. And a fellow Linux Chicks LA-er. So, and he goes to Scale. So I was happy he was there and got to catch up with him and all the chicks. And we made actually quite a few plans for upcoming things we're going to do at our monthly meetings. So we do monthly virtual meetings.
Virtual or ritual?
Virtual online meetings. We want to do in IRL meetings again too. We're looking for a location, and we have several people who have sponsored us, so we got to decide where we're gonna have our in IRL meetings.
fun. And we played a little bit of Tuesday. We had a little bit of
a scare
about 15 minutes before we went live. We play a classic game called Trackmania 2. We got a group. We got room for like four more members if you want to participate. There's no application. You just come in and play with us on Tuesdays and Fridays. Trackmania 2 Stadium. The authentication servers went down, so I couldn't bring our private server up. And we were sitting there like, uh-oh. And I'm sitting here, get everything cut on, and I try to get the server to start up. Wasn't having it. And this entire time, I'm just watching people show up in Discord getting ready. I'm like, we might not be doing anything. And, like, no joke, 4 minutes before we went live, everything worked itself out. I was like, thank you for that stress. I needed that in my life.
Oh, boy.
Speaking of fun things and stress, Monday, I had jury duty.
Oh, that's right. I remember you were telling me that was coming up.
It was coming up. It was on Monday. That was the adventure. I'm just going to put it like this. It resulted in me, I get there, it's the courthouse. Where's it at? Oh, it's state court I got to go to. Top of the building. Fifth floor. Guess what was broken?
Elevator?
Yep. Okay. It's like, of course. Of course.
Boy.
Five flights. Get up there. Chill out. Wait for an hour and a half outside the courtroom for whatever reason. Finally come in. We're like one side. Then they get on the other side. You know, there's like 83 people. And they're like, everybody on that side, you can go home now. I'm like, oh no, I gotta wait around more. Everybody on this side who's past the first three rows, you can go do something for like an hour, then come back. Really? So I went down, you know, I'm not going to like sit there. It's downtown Athens, like went out, got something to drink, played around, went back up five flights of stairs. Jeez. Okay.
Oh, poor
Then they're doing like little preview things like, hang on, let's just ask, you know, some questions to weed out like anybody in case they need backup jurors. And I'm not going to give anything away from the case because it might be going on, but I will say this one thing. This whole thing was over a policy sum of $200 was the case from 4 years ago.
Mm-hmm. I was on one time van where it was only $20 item.
For $200, I had to walk up five flights of stairs.
Yeah, twice. Five flights of stairs. That would have been really bad if they had someone in a wheelchair. Wouldn't have been.
Wouldn't have been able to make it.
Yeah.
Wouldn't have been able to make it. It's a good thing we got excused. You know, they ended up being picked from that. But I'm like, there's no way, because it's like, I'm already mad at this person because, you know, several hours like having to walk upstairs and like over $200. Come on.
Yeah. Well, usually what I found out is this person who reportedly stole $20 worth of hair supply stuff. This is like from 30 years ago. It was someone who had been stealing a lot. So this was like, you know, the fifth time or whatever. So that's why. Like, why are we here for $20?
$20, I don't even know how I would handle that. $200, I know. Like, this is like 80 people tied up into this.
Yeah, tied up. But so it was probably someone who's had issues before, if it's only $200.
Four years ago. And there we go. That was my adventure in doing my civic duty. I didn't get picked, as Adrian once said, if a defense lawyer ever picked me to be on a jury, he could be tried for malpractice. I'm probably not a good candidate. I'm not that type of person. But what else we got going on? Playing around with some audio stuff. Ever interested in audio on Linux? Because, you know, audio doesn't work under Linux. We know that. You know, this is all in your head. It's imagination. This entire audio chain that we have set up for live streaming, recording, me dunking all over Intel's bad audio engineering for their podcast. I needed to set up a couple of things because I use the Stream Deck. You know what a Stream Deck is, right?
Oh, yeah.
You know, for everybody who's going to buy a microphone, they're like, I need a microphone. I need a Stream Deck. For some reason, they think they need an audio mixer, too. That boggles my mind. And, you know, it's the thing that they install and they never use. You know, you go over to their house and there's dust on their Stream Deck. And, you know, if I come over to your house, I'm going to walk over to your mic. I see a microphone arm. I'm going to go. I'm like, yeah, you never use that, do you?
Yeah.
So I make a lot of use of the Stream Deck for these shows because I use an application. I did a video on it maybe about 2 years ago called BitFocus Companion, which allows you to tie in hundreds of services and applications into a Stream Deck that you can use them all at the same time. And the main thing I've been using the Stream Deck for is controlling our switching. I have it tied into OBS. You know, the Stream Deck runs on a Raspberry Pi back in the rack, and it controls the streaming box. So when I hit, you know, I go, boom, I hit the Jill button, it goes to Jill. And I hit a two-shot button, it goes back to two-shot. And, you know, I can control, record, play, all the things. But the cool thing about that is I have like 99 pages of stuff that I can stack on there. And I don't have to just use OBS. I can use OBS with like DMX lighting to control all types. Things you've never even heard of. It's fascinating to go through the list. And, you know, PTZ cameras. And another one, because over here, you can kind of see it right here if you're watching the video version. That's my monitor for Reaper, because we use Reaper for live audio processing and recording. And I wanted a way to do mutes and activate plugins. It's an adventure. Like, I don't know if I'll do a video, but I'll definitely do a written guide of how to get that set up. So when I hit a mute button or activate plugins and move around, it goes to the Raspberry Pi, then it's controlled over OSC, which is the web exposed version of Reaper for, like, if I wanted to create a control surface in a website. It'd be easy to do with that. And that triggers action scripts, and then that it's a Lua script on top of that, and it works, and so I can do all the fun things. So if that crashes, what a biggest thing this week is I'm trying to learn to use my mute button on the Stream Deck, and it's hard to do because I'm so accustomed to reaching over here. Fun times, simple creature. However, we got something way more interesting than any of the audio stuff I'm playing around with, and that's Debian. Debian has went and added RISC-V as an official architecture.
Woohoo!
Makes me so happy.
It's very exciting.
You know, like something, an alternate to ARM. And check this out, though. Like, being named an official architecture, this is just the start. This is just the start. Because you got to think about it. The official all right, let's just back this up then. Dial back the excitement. The official archive, it's a bit bare right now. Like, this just happened a couple of days ago. A lot of work still needs to be done on this because we got to get all the packages and et cetera.
Yeah. Right?
Here's the little blurb from the mailing list. But you got to think about it. Debian is upstream for a lot of other distributions. So that means your RISC-V support is going to be headed to a lot of those. That's where it gets like really interesting. You think your Ubuntu's, your Mint's, and all the other Debian-based spins. What about Arch? I'm sure Arch has already added the support for it, whatever. But what I want to talk about is what we all know that we can just run out and buy RISC-V SBCs. They're out there right now, right? Mm-hmm. We've talked about them over the years. That's neat. That's neat. Where it gets interesting for me, Jill, is there's about four companies right now that are working on server class chips, you know, something with like Xeon like performance, or I guess we should say Epic performance in this modern day and age. But, that's where I get excited because maybe, just maybe in our future, we're going to have an option for something other than x86 on the desktop, right? And it might be RISC-V instead of ARM.
And that's what I'm hoping, because it's even, you know, more powerful than ARM chips, or the RISC chip. And the fact that it's legacy code and hardware that's, that's coming to the modern world, finally. You know, my DEC Alpha from 1995 was RISC-based. So it's really nice to have an open source option now, and one that we can put in the hands of consumers. Yeah, and I really knew that this was coming soon because I'd been paying attention to the Debian threads on it. And as usual, you know, and they're in the forefront. And this is just so exciting. It's yet another architecture that Debian supports. And yes, it's very important because it is the foundational Linux distro. And so many people rely on it. and you know, it's... because of the stability, it's used in, you know, everything from manufacturing to space, you know, NASA and SpaceX. It's very important in our world.
It's OG. I run it on every single box in this studio, not because I have some like love or affinity for Debian. No.
Aw.
It's because it works.
Yes.
It's the right tool for the job. If you need to build a workstation, if you need to build an, I don't care if it's a video workstation, audio workstation, Debian's one you pick. I'm sure no one on the internet will disagree with me on that, guaranteed. Very happy to see, and I really want to stress, like, their first step is to, like, get the initial 90 packages built for this.
Yeah.
Before it starts rolling out.
And that's always the challenge. You remember, Ven, how long it's taken them to get ARM packages? You know, even now, we're still trying to get, you know, software on ARM. So and that's improving a lot, but now we're gonna have to turn around and developers are gonna have to do that for the RISC platform.
Well, if you've been around long enough, especially on Linux, you will remember how long it took to get x86-64.
That
remember
was
moving
too.
To 64-bit. I remember doing my first install of Fedora, because that's what we ran back in the day, and they had x86-64 support, and I put that in. Couldn't watch anything because all the media codecs were 386 or 32-bit, I should say. And that was hard couple of years before everything got moved over to 64-bit, except for Steam, because Valve refuses to make a 64-bit client for Linux or Windows. So you're going to run into stuff like that.
Debian. Yeah. I love Debian.
Debian on RISC. I want to play around with RISC. Yeah. It needs to grow up a little bit. It's got to get to a usable state. Having options with SBCs, you know, when they get a little more powerful, is always a good thing. Because it's just been ARM, all the things. Now, then again, we might end up with ARM desktops. We might still end up with x86 desktops. Who knows? I don't know. I'm not Moore. I don't make laws. We'll figure it out.
Yeah.
Something that does have an x86 processor in it that you're not going to mind because it's so cool is Framework.
Yeah. So Framework has just announced they are now taking pre-orders for the much anticipated 16-inch display version of their modular, sustainable, and repairable Framework laptop. And the Framework Laptop 16, it has four layers of modular components, including a swappable discrete GPU. That's the big deal right there. A swappable discrete GPU. And it is powered by an AMD Ryzen 040HS CPU and an optional AMD Radeon RX 7700S graphics module with 8 gigabytes of GDDR6 memory. And it also has a fully customizable and hot swappable input modules. This is also something very cool. You can center offset your selected keyboard as well as choose between a numpad, spacers in a range of colors, an LED matrix module that will show you your CPU and GPU temperatures, and or a RGB micropad. And there are actually keyboard options for white backlit or per key RGB unicorn vomit, if you so choose. And like previous Framework laptops, you have the ability to swap out expansion slots. The Framework Laptop 16 has 6 ports to customize to your heart's content. You can choose from a USB-C, USB-A, HDMI, DisplayPort, microSD, Ethernet, audio, ultra-fast storage, and other options. And you can pre-order the DIY edition starting at $1,399 or pre-order the pre-built kit for $1,699. And put one of your favorite Linux distros on it, like Fedora and Ubuntu. This is just so cool. This is the laptop I have been looking forward to from Framework. And this will be my next laptop I purchase, for sure. You know, not only because it has a much larger 16-inch display that would be easier for me to see and use compared to the previous model's small 13-inch display, but because it has the ability to use a hot, swappable, discrete GPU. This is so cool, Vin. You know, you can game, podcast, and do content creation with the discrete Ryzen GPU. And then when you're done with heavy tasks, you can take the discrete GPU out and use the onboard Ryzen APU for day-to-day tasks and save battery life. It's the ultimate laptop. You can make it what you want. That's the beauty of it. And that's the beauty of Framework. They're incredible.
I think like a lot of you... Now, all this is going to be in our show notes. Don't worry about it. If you're watching the video version, where you're just scrolling down, you're like, ah, it's Framework. Neat. You already know the deal. Then you got to this. Then you got to this.
Yes.
And your only thought was, wait a minute. What are you doing? Oh, you're putting in a keyboard? Okay, that's... And you're putting in a number pad next to a keyboard? Wait a minute.
Yeah.
That's illegal. You're not allowed to do that. But with a Framework, you absolutely can. And imagine being able to have a, well, number pad-ish like device next to an offset keyboard. I think that is a brilliant, brilliant idea. Mm-hmm. Now, one of the things we were talking about on Saturday, I think it's in 2025, the EU has passed a law, or is going to implement or enact, I guess we should say, a law where you have to have removable batteries in all devices.
Yeah.
Now, on Saturday, we were talking about how is this going to affect the Steam Deck, which it will. You don't think about things like that, but you know, you can technically replace the battery in the Steam Deck if you get a lot of time and some prying because it's glued on there. That's going to have to change. And, you know, this is really aimed at like mobile devices and things like that, but laptops fall into this category. And I used framework as an example because for years and years and years and years, I'm like, why can't we get, you know, the DIY market? It's like, why can't we get like a standard, like an ATX equivalent form factor standard for laptops? You know, because we all know the nightmare of like, oh no, nice. I need to replace this part on this laptop. Oh boy, I hope I can find it.
Or it costs more than the laptop is worth.
Because somebody's like, you know, you just couldn't buy that one part. You were buying it from somebody who, or you had to buy the entire laptop used to get the one thing.
Yeah.
We've all had variations of that. And you think about screens and things like that. But the thing is, like, Dell had said, you know, HP, you know, your Lenovo. So like, listen, everybody. We can't make modular laptops because they're going to be big, bulky, and super expensive. You're not going to want them. And it took this long, and I think this is a lot of the excitement with framework, for framework just to call BS on all that. They're like,
yeah,
they've done nothing but lie to you. We can make a sleek, affordable, even as a smaller company, affordable laptop with all of these options, and they knocked it out of the park with their first one.
Yeah, absolutely.
They really flipped that equation on the side of, like, I think it might have been Dell. Dell's like, we're getting to research laptops that you can kind of upgrade after telling you that it was completely impossible. And I like this future. And, you know, you can swap out the batteries. You can swap out the keyboard. You can swap out the screens. Frameworks got it down. And for a higher-end laptop, being able to get the DIY edition for $1,300, that's not unreasonable.
Yeah. Yeah, that's for what you're getting, you know, something that's upgradable, repairable, sustainable, you know, on top of being a high-end laptop. I mean, you can pay that much just for a regular laptop from the store. You might as well buy one that you can upgrade later and reuse parts from.
Think about how much computer you're going to get. $1,300 framework, or from how much compute power and usability you're going to get from that versus a $1,300 MacBook.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like, if you can get a MacBook for $1,300 these days.
Yeah.
Oh, and by the way, that MacBook's going to have soldered in storage and memory.
Yes.
So you won't ever be able to upgrade it.
Yeah. And the OS eventually will stop supporting it. So that's where Linux comes along and saves the day.
It's kind of wild. And you could run everything you want on this. You know, there's no locking. You run Windows. You can run Fedora. You can run Debian. All the fun stuff that you would. Somebody go install Haiku on it because, you know, there's that one weirdo there.
Yeah.
And this is brilliant. If you want to get the pre-built, yeah, it's $1,600. I do want to point out the demand for these things. I'd have to go back and double check this, but the last I heard that, like, the ship date for these pre-orders have already been moved, because this is kind of early to Q1 of next year.
Yes.
So there's going to be a bit of a wait. We'll keep that in mind. Up next is a program that I love to hate on, but it works. It's the best tool for the job. DaVinci Resolve. DaVinci Resolve is the, for the past about 3.5 years, every bit of video you've ever seen on Linux Teamcast has been through DaVinci Resolve at some point. And 18.5 is out. I've been testing the beta for quite some time. What is it? Currently, it's like 200. It's still under $300 if you want to get the pro version. The non-pro, they just call it like the studio, not the studio, just the regular version. It's got some limitations in it, but it gives you an idea of whether or not you'd want to buy it, which is always good. This, nothing huge to report on, I'm going to be really, but this has got a bunch of updates. It's just, I'm going to be honest with you, there's like 150 new features. Mm-hmm. I felt like one of them that was kind of useful for me, and that's, I tend to only talk about stuff I know about, and, well, something I do know about is its ability to generate subtitles. It can do that. Why? Because it can do transcriptions of your audio. So here's like a complete list of this. If you don't know DaVinci Resolve, non-linear video editor, started out on Linux. It was Linux first, later got ported to Mac, then Windows. And it's generally available. I'll tell you about some of the downfalls. But, you know, not anything's perfect, but here's the thing. Before I do any of that, I went too long on that. I got to give DaVinci Resolve credit because I bought a license for DaVinci Resolve at version 14. Where are we at right now? Version
18.5. 18.5, wow.
Now, here's the other thing. If I bought a version, bought a license of, let's say I bought the DaVinci Resolve editing system and I paid, was it $20,000? I would still be able to upgrade from that version one because they don't nickel and dime you. It's not a subscription. You buy the software. It just works.
Mm-hmm.
And you're done with it. How rare is that in 2023?
Yeah.
They're not trying to get you. No, Blackmagic has a subscription service, but it's for their cloud hosting and editing. So if you want to do collaborative online editing and stuff like that, it's available. But the application itself has always been, you just get the free updates. I want to give them credit for that.
Mm-hmm.
However, being able to transcribe the audio and video. So I take like Linux Gamecast or a couple of segments. You've been out and you've been shooting stuff. Let's say you get like 5 or 6 hours worth of footage. You drop everything from all the sources into your timeline. Get the audio in there. Man. And let's say you've been shooting this stuff all week, right? You've been doing a couple of different things.
Mm.
Where was I talking about the thing at? Oh boy, I got to scrub through 5 hours worth of footage and see if I can find the part where I was talking about the thing. Transcribe all the audio. It does a really good job on it. You can search through that audio for what you were saying, and it'll jump to that part in the timeline.
That's amazing.
On that video clip. It doesn't have to be in one single clip. It can be multicam, whatever you got set up. You're like, where was that conversation?
Nice.
Boom, there it is. Like, oh, there. It's like, that's useful. That's useful. I like that because I always do like little stinger things at the beginning of a Linux Gamecast. You know, it's like, oh, we have like a little funny ha-ha, a joke.
Yeah.
You know, something to kind of give you an idea of what you're in before in that first, you know, 5 or 6 seconds. And I remember what it is. I'm like, oh, I have no idea when we did it though. So instead of scrubbing through that, I can run the transcribe on the audio and type in, you know, a couple of swipes at like, what was the topic that I thought was fun, and boom, there it is. Like, oh, neat. Cut it up, slap at the front. It's wicked, wicked easy. And also, as you might just assume, if you're able to transcribe all the audio, and I'm going to say accuracy, it's higher than Whisper. I played around. I did some A/B testing with Whisper. This is all self-contained using the DaVinci Neural Engine. It's not done online. You can cut the box off from the internet and used it just to verify that. Works locally. And I'm going to say probably 98% accurate. You know, like anything, any type of auto transcription, you're going to have to go back and like fine tune anything, but you can use that to create subtitles on top of everything else.
Yeah.
And they're already time matched. So you're not have to manually insert them, and it's got the options like how it's just super cool.
It's AI put to good use.
150 new features.
Yeah.
I found one that I really liked. Now, something I do want to talk about every time I talk about DaVinci Resolve, it's got problems on Linux that they've never addressed, and they're very much like, la, 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 it's not a problem, and they're real problems, especially the more I do. No support for audio plugins under Linux. So no support for VST, VST3, LV2, or Clap, like just across the board. So if you get a bunch of audio plugins that you traditionally use in a DAW to edit your audio, like you should, instead of trying to edit your audio in a video editor, but you get some leeway with DaVinci Resolve because it also has Fairlight. You don't just get Resolve, you get Fusion, you get Fairlight.
You get Fusion, Fairlight, yeah, and color correction. Fairlight
is their audio application. You're stuck with the built-in suite that comes, you know, it's about 20 different things. And my personal ranking of the built-in plugins range from, how do I put, there's not a nice way to put this, from ooh to I sincerely hope nobody's ever used this in production. It's my scale. They're just not good. Like last resort I'd use them on. So that is a big sticking point. It still cannot to this day import AAC audio.
Yeah.
On Linux. It doesn't matter if you have the studio version like I have. Can't do it. It's not that it can't. It's not a technical limitation. It's just black magic being black magic. They're like, meh. So you still have to, you know, export and or transcode your audio to something that it can handle. What else are some big ones? Your social media on Windows and Mac. You can link all of your social media, your TikToks, YouTubes, any place that you would upload to Vimeo, and just automatically upload directly to the service. Can't do that on Linux. That's a limitation. And is there another one that drives me up the wall? I think that's roughly
those it. Those are the two, yeah.
But everything else works out of the box. I like it. Eventually, I'm going to find me one of those Arc. Do you hear that?
Yes. Oh, boy.
Power! I've never understood the point of that. You know, even as a teenager, when I was into shouty cars, I was like, I would take my shouty cars, like, out in the country to be shouty about it, right?
Yeah, yeah. Not in the city.
Oh, but hey, you know, people like loud noises, I guess. DaVinci Resolve, happy to play with it. It is, if I'm not trying to sell, I don't make anything from this, obviously, and I've definitely been in arguments with Blackmagic developers before on multiple occasions. If you've watched my videos where it took an entire year to get a thing fixed. It's stable.
Yeah, it's very stable.
It doesn't crash and we're talking about hundreds of gigabytes of stuff I've thrown into these things, hours upon hours. We're talking like 11, 12 hours editing. If I get DaVinci, if I manage to make DaVinci Resolve crash, it's always followed by verbally going, yeah, I deserve that. I probably shouldn't have been running that. Right?
Yeah, yes.
You know what? That one's on me, all right? My bad. My bad. And, you know, AMD, no, all right. I did the one video a couple of months ago about getting it up and running on, because you need the AMD Pro driver.
Yeah.
And you find out how much AMD loves Linux the second you have to install software from AMD. And you're like, oh, they don't care about Linux. I'm like, no, not even a little bit. We need to thank all of our open source developers that have made awesome drivers for AMD.
Yeah.
AMD on desktop for Linux, like, they don't care that you exist. Intel, you're not doing much better. I'll eventually get like one of those 770s or something. Maybe Battle Mage will be out by the time. And we'll find out whether or not DaVinci Resolve works well under Linux. I don't know. Joe, you got some thoughts on it?
Yeah, I was excited about this. You can now import and export timeline using the Open Timeline IO format, which is an industry standard open source interchange format and API for editorial cut information that was actually created by Pixar Animation Studios. And I've used it in many programs, including Final Cut Pro and Avid and Blender. And there is also a hardware accelerated encode support for AV1 on AMD systems. That's exciting. We're finally getting GPU acceleration on DaVinci with AMD, which is really nice. And also, DaVinci Resolve 18.5 has the ability to import MKV movie chapters as media markers and the ability to export timeline markers as MKV chapters. That's going to prove very helpful and probably for Ven too in doing edits on shows.
You think I use Matroska containers? Quit being silly.
I know you don't, but who knows, you may someday.
I'd used them in the past. I use move containers for everything.
Yeah. I use a MKV when I'm teaching DaVinci with my students. Yeah. So it's a thing.
All right. So there you go. Run out, play with it if you want. It's free to download, free to play with. It is a really rough experience if you're outside of our friendly, loving NVIDIA ecosystem. But if you just, you know, if you're one of those rare weirdos that has an NVIDIA GPU, like 80% of the market, try it out. If you got an Arc, write in. Let me know if it works.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm going to test it myself eventually. But yeah, like I've asked the Bing box, the Google box, the DuckDuck Quack box. Mm-hmm. I'm like, hey, has anybody tested this? And there's like the one guy on Reddit. He's like, yeah, it works great. No problems whatsoever. Which is like, that guy probably doesn't even know what DaVinci Resolve is or
owns an art card, right? No explanation. I know it works great on Blender because Blender has software developed specifically for it now.
They also haven't updated their binary Linux drivers in like 6 months.
In a long time. Yeah.
Oh, these are like all like fun equations that I've, Intel's not been a good steward of desktop Linux either so far. However, we're seeing like jumps in the Mesa stack.
Absolutely.
People are starting to learn about the ARC architecture, and we're seeing some like just performance boosts. I want one to play with. That's why I say I want one to play with to find all that, because we desperately need that player three in everything else. But before we get out of here, that's going to be all of our DaVinci Resolve talk. If you want to edit videos, try KDE in live, see if it works for you.
Yeah.
Hopefully it does. Works
beautifully.
There's but if you need to, move up a little bit and also have some of that transferable knowledge, which I'm a big fan of transferable knowledge. And if you want to learn something that you can take out and get a job doing, DaVinci Resolve is handy for that,
Absolutely.
There's production houses, but that's what they use.
It's industry standard. In fact, it's beating the Premiere and After Effects in a lot of areas.
They're making inroads in the houses because it's cheap. Yeah. You don't have that subscription service.
Absolutely.
And they're really trying to cut into them with a cloud system, which I'm like, well, you guys have fun doing that. Anyway,
and it works on Linux.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, that's all we care about.
Yes.
Now, what is this title, Jill? No power, no problem?
Yeah. So this is something really cool. This is a Raspberry Pi project that is very unique. And you can actually get the game Doom running on just about, every piece of hardware. But this project actually takes it to the next level. Running Doom on a Raspberry Pi wirelessly. Yes, not plugged in. The developer had started playing with the cool wireless LEDs that are out there and has been messing around with wireless charging technology. And after getting a set of wireless charging PCBs and other parts, he thought it might be fun to try and run a Raspberry Pi Zero W2 with a wireless transmitter and receiver boards. And to make it a real test, he ran Doom on the Pi with a nice little small TFT screen. And it worked. And there's a lot more to it than what I just said, but you can check out all of his documentation and parts that he used in the show notes. It was really quite a fascinating read, and I know Ven enjoyed this one as well.
This is neat. This is neat. I mean, my first thought was like, well, does it run Doom? And that was one of the subreddits I still follow. And of course, a Raspberry Pi Zero W2 can run Doom. I know. It's amazing if you're of a certain age. But using, inductive charging or just inductive power with no batteries, like, you know what? That would make a good YouTube. Oh, here's the YouTube video. Of course you did it for a YouTube video. I don't blame you. I'm not hating on you. It's just neat. It's something to watch. Maybe you want to play around with yourself. I mean, far as I'm concerned, inductive charging is still 100% Scandinavian witchcraft, which I joke about. It's just, I would like to see efficiency gains in that. With inductive charging, because it's so wholly inefficient. It's one of those things, you put something down, you come back, it's got some charge to it, you leave it overnight, it's probably a good idea. I think we all want a world where we can get like a good, fully covered, full, like big chunky desk mat with inductive charging built in.
Oh, yeah. Well, Logitech does make one for their wireless.
I'm not buying Logitech anything. Logitech has been out for like 30 years and they still can't make a micro switch that doesn't die in 9 months.
Although I'm using a Logitech mouse and this one is 15 years old.
Yeah, but I use mine more. Jill's holding up an example of a mouse I can crush in my hand.
Yes. Yeah. It's a little, one of those little baby portable mice, but it fits my hand perfectly and it's pink.
Here's my Logitech mouse.
Yes. It's got that nice classic Logitech. Does it work Logitech.
For me very well.
That Logitech scroll wheel that I love and that click that I love.
Oh, man. Yeah. So I've replaced the Logitechs are the reason I know how to rebuild micro switches and can easily replace micro switches. Mm-hmm. And if you're ever curious, just do a search online and find the tens of thousands of people complaining about Logitech micro switches. So you know that you're not alone. But it's good to be an anomaly, isn't it, Jill?
I got one that worked. Definitely. I did have one that died 2 years ago, so I know what you're talking about.
Oh, man. You know what? Maybe we should look at it a better way. I'm not hating on you, Logitech. My personal experience. Because it's like, let's face it, I would still buy like that C920 webcam, stuff like that. Decent. I don't have a problem with them. I would like, mm-hmm. even if Logitech made it, let's just get like a good, cheap standard for everything. Like, I don't ever have to want to worry about compatibility either, right?
Yeah.
Like, you know, I'd like my trackball, I'd like to be able to just put that on the desk, put my number, shut up, I have a wireless number pad, shut up, put that on the desk, and, you know, keyboard as well, and just other devices, and just have laying around everywhere, and wonder how come my arms grew horns. That'd be awesome, though. I pay extra for that.
Yes.
that's really cool. I like seeing people play around, and, you know, especially like with the LEDs. Come on, that.
Yeah, that's amazing. I've been fascinated by them as well.
Like, let's be honest, and like collectively, and all of our silly monkey brains were like, "That's magic. That's so cool." You know, they're just blinking by themselves and plan doom all the fun stuff that you can do. And hey, look, there's not really a bill of material here, but all the links to get stuff on AliExpress. Mm-hmm. And that you'd want to play with. Very happy to see it. Very happy to see it. Now, before we get out of here and roll the credits, I got to thank Ian, who is a new executive producer, joined us, patreon.com/LinuxGamecast, you wacky people who make our shows possible. You know, we don't stop and tell you about mattresses or new boxer shorts with inductive charging on them, although I might cover that if those exist. We don't do any ads, and we haven't done any ads in a decade. And to do what we do at the size and scale that we do is all done by listener support. And it's quite awesome because we just get to do it kind of how we want to. If you want to help out with that, head over to LinuxGamecast.com, smash that support button, Patreon, Libra, Pay. We even got crypto things. We got Amazon wishlist. I got one for the studio. If you're ever curious about stuff I'm planning on buying, you want to help out with that, I will publicly shame you on the board behind me. And there's nothing you can do about that. We got a merch store, Amazon storefront, if you want to see all the items that I bought for the studio and judge me on that. And of course, Humble affiliate codes. But thank you to Ian, our latest executive producer. Hop at our Discord. Yay. That's active 7 days a week. 24 hours a day.
Yeah, absolutely. 24 hours.
it's everything. It's a delightful group of miscreants, and we're all over the place, which is a good time. Mm-hmm. Come join us this Friday if you want a little puzzle platforming for some track mania. We'll be doing that. And tomorrow, tune in for the fifth stream of Portal Reloaded co-op. Mm-hmm. With Jordan and Empty.
Yay.
As they're already starting to resent each other. It's glorious. Yeah. Like, and I know this as somebody who publicly went through Portal co-op, and like you build that relationship and it becomes antagonistic very quick. And you're like, oh, we got to figure this out together, but we got to work on a team, and it's good for that. And Portal Reloaded is regular portals, but with a time portal. So yes, instead of just back and forth, they got to deal with the present, past, and future on top of every map.
Yeah.
And it will hurt your brain.
It does.
And hopefully everything gets sorted out. I've reworked Jordan's outdoor live stream setup for his session. So I worked on that yesterday for about half a day. Got it tightened up. Well, I think I did it on Tuesday. Yeah, yesterday was Tuesday, right? That's how days work. Really?
Yes.
So it's going to sound, should sound a lot better. He'll be testing that hopefully in production tomorrow if he gets a chance, because Empty's kind of got a less than stellar like, headset a little microphone.
Tinny. Yes.
So I got my EQ shovel out and started carving into that a little bit and got him set up with also a good limiting amplifier. And
cool.
It sounds as, I've polished the you know what out of the you know what.
Mm-hmm.
So it'll sound all right. 7:30 tomorrow night, Friday, Backtrack Mania's Linux Gamecast Weekly. 8:30 back here on Twitch. All right, everybody.
Yeah.
Halfway through the week. Friday's coming.
Yay.
Let's roll some credits.
It's Wednesday. Be happy. Friday's only 2 days away. We have lots of wonderful patrons and viewers to thank, including our advisors. We have actually Artherin is in chat right now, and we also have Omegas as an advisor. Our executive producers, Barbrandt, Scott M, Atomic, and Mike G, drummer. And our Chicago people, Super Dust Out, Empty, Blasphemy. And our sea monsters, Ronaldo, Ryder, Ex Machina. That's as far as I could get through that list. And the Death Notes. Too many of them for me to name, and the Cherylings, even more of them to name. That
385. What you got to do is you got to do all the what is it, countries in the world song from like Animaniacs and
Yeah, that would be awesome. I haven't heard that. Oh, that brings back memories. I haven't heard that in a while, Ben.
Hey, everybody, we gotta run. See you next week.
Bye, you guys.